Us and the Lions has always have like a sort of rivalry this year.
We know how they play, and I think we know their play style. Before they said also that they kind of know our weakness, but I'm not sure, because I think we played a wide champion pool in the in our semi-final, and we showed that we can play everything.
It's a fact that when Alliance is ahead early, they stay for one or two times, I think they won all their games.
We know that we can always win, even if we're behind. We know that the enemy is going to make a mistake most of the time.
The best way for us to beat Alliance is just to play solid and avoid mistakes, because they can punish really hard for mistakes.
It feels like the one that makes the least mistakes is the one that wins.
I think Fnatic makes quite a lot of mistakes, yeah. Like, I think if they don't snowball against us, that we're going to win the game.
Our problem kind of sometimes is that we are really greedy and we try to do the greedy thing and we just get punished incredibly hard.
Even if you manage to win one lane, the other lanes are gonna be equal or ahead, so it's never, you're never gonna be able to snowball a game just from the laning phase versus them, because they know how to handle their lanes.
The main goal was to participate to Worlds. We got that, now we have to win the split.
It's about time to put Alliance first. Last season we didn't quite do it and we lost against them in semifinals, but this time I believe we have the stronger cards.
Yeah, I've been working for this for like a year now. We always knew from the start we could work, well, we could all be really, really good, but we can also work together, so I like that a lot.
This team was built to be number one.
Welcome back, everyone. I'm joined here by Trevor Quickshot Henry and Mitch Prepo Vorspiels, and we're just moments away from game one. Now, gentlemen, what are your predictions for this series? Of course, what a fantastic matchup, and you got to feel the pressure is off, but on the other hand, it's still on because they want to win this.
Well, I think for this series, there's more pressure on Alliance than there is on Fnatic. Everybody is anticipating Fnatic to just sort of walk away at the sun. It's on Alliance to break the streak. It's on Alliance to live up to the Super Team title, and it's on Alliance to come back from some of the mistakes that were made in the semi-final. So I think Alliance can do it. I called Alliance to be the Summer Split champions all the way back in week one, and I think this is their time. They look confident, they have been playing strong, and they've beat Fnatic three times out of the last four games they've played in the regular season.
See, I don't really like this prediction game, so I'm not going to play it.
You're not very good at it from what I remember.
Oh, I won the last time. Anyways, I think this series is going to end in a 3-1. In either team's favor. I think like once a team gets far enough up, like the mental aspect of a best of five final is so big that I think one team will just get mentally broken at one point. And I would love to see all five games. And I don't care who wins, because I'm really good friends with the Alliance, because obviously I played in half their team.
Such a cop out.
Yeah, I'm copping out right now. So if you say Alliance, I'll say Fnatic, I guess.
Well, of course, we'd love to see five games. I would also like to hear from all of you as well. Head over to Twitter and let us know which team in this series do you think will be crowned the Kings of Summer and why. So, I mean, Trevor, I don't have to ask. You have a lot of trust in Alliance.
Yeah, trust is a strong word. I believe in Alliance. We'll see. And I think if they make mistakes, they could be in trouble. But yes, I'm calling it for Alliance.
Repo.
Well, I think Alliance, but I've played against Fnatic in these type of finals, and it's always a different Fnatic that shows up. It's never the same one that you're used to. They always have like one of these curveballs or a silly level one, and you find five people in the top lane. It's really hard to call this one.
Yeah, we will see. Now tweet us at LOL Esports with your answer, along with the hashtag AllWin or FNCWin, and we'll read your answers later in the show. Now you can also go to lolesports.com for information about the teams, the players, the schedule, and more as we continue down the road to Worlds. Now we know you're ready for this series to begin, so let's send it over to our trio of casters to kick things off.
Thank you very much, Shox. It is indeed time for the two best teams in Europe to square off for the title of Summer Split Champions and first place seed at Worlds. So let's break down these two teams, starting out in the top lane. It is a battle between Wicked and SOAZ, and this was a battle for the All-Stars in which SOAZ was the one that came out ahead. But that was a year ago now. The current meta plays into the favor of both of the players. Wicked, he works very well with the tanky style and the wider choice of champions. Well, that plays well into SOAZ's favor.
I 100% agree, and SOAZ has just been getting better and better towards the end of this split here. We did look at his performance in the start of the split and say, okay, he needs to find his champion pulls now. He was just trying a lot of different things. All of a sudden, he found it. He's been playing better and better in the playoffs. He's been looking strong. I mean, he played five different champions in the semifinals. That really shows how big your champion pool actually is. Wicked, on the other hand, while we sometimes even get stuck on a few champions only, we always talk about his champion pool. He did show a swing in the semifinal and actually worked out pretty well for him. So he's also been expanding the champion pool a little bit here and could potentially surprise us today.
So Shook and Cyanide is the battle then in the jungle. Shook has been the man really helping carry his team, and he was involved in 79% of Alliance's kills versus SK Gaming. And it's nothing new that Cyanide is not really carrying as hard for Fnatic, but that's because his style is a lot more passive than Shook's overall.
Yeah, so we have the carry jungler from Alliance, and then we have the support jungler from Fnatic. It's not a bad deal or bad thing to be the support jungler, because Cyanide is exactly the type of player Fnatic needs. They have carry players in every single other role. Even their support, Yellowstar, can carry games here. So they need a person like Cyanide who can help his lanes, who can focus on getting wards down, and it's paying off for the team. Shook, on the other hand, from Alliance, he's a playmaker. He wants to be the guy to carry. And we've also seen him show great synergy together with Froggen in the mid lane, where they often like to gank early on and get Froggen ahead.
Well, speaking of that mid lane, they are probably the most famous members of both teams. They have their highlight reels across the years, and despite Froggen not winning MVP, he has easily been better of the two this season.
Yeah, and Froggen was the MVP of the semifinal, we can say. Nobody was going to stop him from getting to Worlds, because especially in Game 1 and Game 2, he just took the entire team on his back. He kept the Alliance in the game, ended up actually winning at least the first one. The second one, SKG managed to win it, but the first one was all Froggen playing so, so well. And Xpekka in the semifinal, he looked great in lane against Overpower, but he was caught out a few times in the team fights, which is something he can't afford to do against Alliance here. We did see some good stuns, and of course in the last game we saw the perfect Orianna play from him against Rocket.
I love the fact that Froggen's in his all-star jacket. He's like, yeah, I was captain, I won.
Just trying to stamp his authority on this mid lane fight. The AD carries and Tabs and Reckless have been prolific all season long for their teams. That didn't really change in the semi-finals either. Tabs died only once against SK Gaming and managed to rack up a crazy 44 KDA. Reckless died six times versus Rockout, but that game was, we have to say, much closer. The big pick here, though, could be Kog'Maw, which they both did great work on.
Yeah, it will definitely be one of the big picks. I mean, the hyper carries have been in focus the entire playoff, actually, and it won't change here. We're going to see AD carry bans, we're going to see them being first picked, maybe even Froggen playing Tristana mid lane again just to take it away from Reckless here. So it's going to be a lot of focus on these AD carries here. And if you just look at Reckless and Taps, I mean, these are the two best AD carries in Europe facing each other right here. There's no question about is anyone else in top two. No. These two are the two best AD carries we have. Regis was just awarded MVP, but knowing Taps, he's going to do everything in his power to show that he's the best AD carry tonight.
Yeah, most kills, least deaths. Definitely Reckless in the driving seat on that one. Finally, of course, the supports alongside them. The AD carries are not complete without these guys, Nif and Yellowstar. And for me, Yellowstar, he is the number one, often dictating the plays for his team. They both make some exceptional plays, but they also play the same champion. So I expect this one to be pretty high priority in the pick and bans, the Nami, the Morgana, and maybe even the Thresh.
So a lot of Nami bans from SK Gaming against Nif, of course, and Morgana was the hard contested pick for Yellowstar as well. But Yellowstar, for me, has been the support making the most big plays this split here, especially on like Thresh and Morgana. Time and time again, we see it. He set up the kills for Reckless and the rest of the team, while Nif, he's just consistently good. Like, every single time, he will perform. You don't notice Nif as much as you notice a player like Yellowstar, but he's always there and he's always playing well. I mean, he secured 47 assists in the semifinal versus SK Gaming in 4 games. That's more than Yellowstar got against Rocket, even though he played 5 games.
And let's not forget Yellowstar's triple kill in that Baron pit that actually took away the record from Reckless.
True, yeah.
Could have had the record if it wasn't Morgan for him. Scumbag. So, pick and bans, they're going to be getting underway in a moment. Anything we particularly see in this? We've talked about the top lanes, you know, big priorities there. Maybe try and take something away from Wicked. That's how it used to work against Alliance.
True.
Supports, they want the same thing. AD carries, pretty flexible. Mid laners can play anything. This is a pretty wide open pick and ban phase.
So these two teams are so even in terms of like skill. It's going to come down to champ select, a big part of it at least. And if you do look at the bans from the semifinal, Alliance against SK Gaming banned Nidalee in every single game and banned Orianna in 3 out of 4 games. Source played Nidalee against Rocket. He's a great Nidalee player. He's one of the first ones to do it. It's going to be banned against him, at least in the first game. And I predict it to be banned in every single game because Wicked doesn't play it. And Orianna as well was banned against Xpekka 4 out of 5 games in their semifinal. I also expect that one to be banned by Alliance.
Well, you're not too wrong on that one. We see Nidalee being banned here by Alliance. My question, if we'd have had time for it, there was, would we see Syndra get taken away from Peke? And that question is answered. Syndra, the second ban for Alliance. On the other side, Fnatic going for a standard red side casting, also taking away Ahri from Froggen.
And can't really blame them for taking away the Ahri. Froggen was so good on it in the semi-final and carried the Alliance into this big final we have here. Syndra was not the greatest pick for XPEC in the mid lane, but it's simply because they want to target him once again now. Orianna also, as we just talked about, being banned against him, Alliance banned it against SK Gaming, Rocket banned it against Fnatic. It makes a lot of sense here. Make sure XPEC can dominate the lane, because look here, two lane bullies taken away from XPEC. It's up to Froggen now to win the lane on his own and carry the game.
Yeah, you can see a lot of discussion, a lot of focus on those mid lane bans. This is going to force Froggen and Peke into maybe a situation they don't want. Twitch, the final ban. That's going to force an AD carry pick, and it's Kog'Maw insta-locked in by Alliance.
Well, can't really blame them. Twitch banned away. Taps they played in game one, where SK Gaming were picking Tristana, and they used it just for the mid-game power spike of Twitch to try and shut down the Tristana. This time around, no Twitch being banned. Should be a Tristana pick then for Reckless over here, unless he feels like he want to play Corki and trying to win in the mid-game.
Well, we'll find out here whether they actually bother with then that AD carry pick in their first round. One thing that we should note here, the likes of Maokai not spotted here anywhere in the bans. Will we see Soaz take that though?
Well, Soaz or Fnatic banned Maokai in all five games against Rocket, so it doesn't seem like Soaz actually plays it. Wicked does on the other hand.
And on the flip side, Nidalee is wide open as well, so that could indeed be played by Atalice banned first pick. Blind. Old age. Yeah. We'll just bring everything into that one. Twisted Fate though. Picked up. We haven't seen Peke play this one in a while. It was an old favorite out of both these mid laners, honestly. But it has been a while since Twisted Fate has been a priority.
Yeah, I mean, it was banned a few times in the playoffs, but it's also been open a lot of times where teams didn't actually pick it here. But that's also Fnatic responding and saying, we have four mid lane bans already. We want to make sure that we get a pick where XPEC not necessarily will win the laning phase, but he can then impact the other lanes. Because they are now not expecting XPEC to actually win one-on-one against Froggen with the two lane bullies, Orianna and Syndra, being banned away from him. So instead, he's now going to focus on helping his side lanes, which actually can work really well, especially if they do manage to shut down taps. Remember, he's immobile. If he doesn't run cleanse, and there's going to be no Mikaels in the laning phase, that's impossible. TF can focus the bottom lane and try and shut down Alliance there.
So, for Alliance then, it looks like Lee Sin will be locked in for Shook, a champion which he's made so many big plays on over the course of the year. And also getting Nami in there for Nip. We talked about the support picks here and how they have a very similar, I think, high priority of three champions, basically. And that's going to go over to Nip. Also, paired with that Kog'Maw, that's a very scary lane.
Yeah, it's a great lane, a lot of poke. Very, one of the strongest lanes we have at the moment. And again, Nami was banned by SK Gaming in three out of four games because they also wanted to run Morgana. And Nami is the lane counter to Morgana here. So we have to see if Fnatic still want to play it. Otherwise, Thresh should be the option for Yellow Star if he wants to play a bit more safe in the laning phase. If he does take the Morgana here, they have to rely on Twisted Fate to help them out in the laning phase. Or Fnatic wants to lane swap then, like we actually see a lot from him.
And of course, that top lane still a question. If Maokai does get locked in, and it is, will we see the Swain counter? Zillion support locked in for Yellow Star.
Played in the OGN finals quite a bit, actually, by Samsung. No, by KT Arrow, sorry. And it simply means the Maokai pick here, if he goes in and tanks up like four members and the backline where you have the Twisted Fate and your AD carry, then takes care of the frontline from Alliance, this Maokai, you have to kill him twice, potentially, unless they, of course, get back Alliance, get to one of the carries, then we have to ult again from Zillion here. So very nice pickup. Actually also pretty good in the laning phase, just not very good against Nami, simply due to the sustain advantage for Nami.
So, other side for Alliance, looking for a top lane choice, and of course the mid laner here for Froggen. What's he going to pull out? There's a lot of bans towards this mid lane, four of them targeted straight in there between Froggen and XPeke. Will it be something like Xerath that he's played, or will he go full on aggression here and play this Fizz?
Just a direct counter to Twisted Fate here, I mean. Froggen is going to have the kill pressure in lane. You have Lee Sin for Shook, where he can apply all the early pressure as well. Oh. And we often see Shook and Froggen work together early on, camp the mid lane. If XPEC falls behind in this lane here, he's going to be in big trouble. And if Froggen decides to run teleport as well, he might be able to follow him around. But now he's not on the teleport. He still wants some even, like, he wants even more kill pressure and lane pressure at the moment.
I wonder if they were trying to bully him into Tristana and Reckless has just said no. Of course, they always knew that Vayne was a possibility for Reckless as a champion. He has been very good on.
Yeah, yes, insane KD on the Vayne, the pentakill against Copenhagen Wolves as well, but it's not going to be a good lane for Fnatic here, so they have to force the lane swap. And we often see when Fnatic have to force the lane swap, they invade into your jungle, they place like four wards deep inside your jungle, one between the two towers as well in the bottom lane or the top lane, depending on where they want to go. And then they try and spot where the enemy dual lane is going and swap around it here. So Fnatic need to get the lane swap going, which can be a bit annoying when you're against an Alistar, who's one of the best top laners at roaming around and ganking early.
They've done a lot of diving in those scenarios as well, when they've though had the likes of Thresh or Morgana in there. Zillion's going to make it a little bit harder to actually lock someone up under that tower to finish him off, but excited to see Reckless as Vayne had a 65 KDA on that coming into playoffs. We'll see if he can go as crazy on it today.
Yeah, some big stats, a lot of big champions for everyone involved. How do you guys at home feel about these lineups? Tweet us hashtag AllWin or hashtag FNCWin for Fnatic to at LOL Esports, and we'll see what you guys think, because this is a tricky one. The balance of power, could we see it shift to Alliance? Fnatic have won this three times running. Nobody else in Europe has won the LCS.
It's just going to be so important in this game for Fnatic. Every time Reckless plays Vayne, they invest a lot of farm, a lot of kills into him, or a lot of gold. They have to do the same here, because he has to be the carry late game together with Xpec, get a two damage threat. They run it before, has backfired, but also worked out.
Well, here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Game one underway. And here at Gamescom, in front of a packed crowd. Alliance starting out as the blue team. Tabs on your screen there. He was in this situation last year for Lemon Dogs. He lost in this final against Fnatic this time. Fnatic, of course, as the red team, with the slight change of Reckless coming in 2014 as the AD carry. Can he be the man to take Fnatic a step further at Worlds? They're gonna go regardless. Can they get further than third place? Will they take that number one seed once again?
And we see a lot of focus on the late game as well for Fnatic with this comp. Pick potential, and you have to go late, to be honest, because Alliance in these mid games fights should be stronger. Once Taps complete his Trinity Force, he's going to be very, very strong. Froggen, I expect him to go out last second item if we actually do see Alliance look for these team fights, and then he can just dive in towards Xpec or Reckless, try and kill them. Of course, he has to kill them twice, which is the annoying part about this support Zillion, but at the same time, Fnatic needs to get the lane swap.
Speaking of the lane swap, Fnatic actually sent Reckless right down to the bottom side of the map. Tabs was there as well, and they basically saw each other, put a ward down a piece, and then actually moved away. We also saw that Alistar started working his way down towards this bottom side of the map. So with Tabs in tow, is this going to be something a little bit tricky from Alliance here at level one?
Well, seems like we have Yellowstar sitting in the mid lane now. We have down his bottom lane, Reckless recalling. He's done this before where he runs down to the lane, just stands there, and then he waits to see, okay, do we spot the enemy dual lane? Then we do recall instantly. Notice what Alliance is doing. They're doing the same mind game Rocket did, where they send Wicked into the lane. So now Fnatic actually believes it's going to be a 2v1 down his bottom lane and a lane swap, and Reckless is staying in the lane. But behind Wicked, we have Taps and Nif waiting, so it's going to be standard lanes, and we can just teleport to the top lane.
It's actually going to be a decent amount of damage here onto Reckless as well. Tab wasn't quite close enough to follow up with that, and of course Nami wasn't quite there either, so they do the damage to Reckless. Wicked's going to TP top, but we already saw the recall coming in from Reckless, and Yellowstar is still in the mid lane harassing Froggen here with a bomb, so they're still going to try and put those two men against Wicked up top.
Just again, mind games by Alliance. We saw the same trick used by Rocket here, and we saw the same reaction from Fnatic. Instant recall from Reckless, go to the top lane. Wicked has been able to pick up some farm, get some experience now. He will push the lane down. If he can push it into the tower in time, he might be able to reset it and still be able to get some experience. Seems like he can't do it, and therefore Reckless should be able to freeze it up in his top lane here and then force Wicked to roam around.
But it's Shook that's going to lose out. He's going to be three buffs to the good for Cyanide. He's going to come around, and that blue buff not there. Instead, he'll take the wolves away and start off there. So he's going to try and keep his experience flowing despite the lack of that big buff. Bottom lane, Tabs is actually shoving the wave fairly heavily, just keeping it outside of range. Yellowstar puts a bomb down. It's going to be so annoying early on for Wicked here.
So So taps down his bottom lane, actually has to push it into the tower simply because it was pushing from the start. He got it reset the first time. Now he has the kind of minion from Fnatic side, and he can actually decide if he wants to freeze it. So he already pushed it into the tower, bounced the wave, reset it, and now it's going to push down towards him, so he can also freeze it together with Rekkles up in the top lane. Both AD carries seem fairly happy, and now we're going to see the roam.
Shock going to move towards this mid lane. Is he going to be able to do anything up there? Preke is decently far up there, but it looks like he's just going to go back into his jungle, keep the farm going on that front, and there he's Foggen again going little aggressive out on towards Xpeke, who pulls the red card. A little bit low on mana there, but shouldn't have too much of a problem in getting that all back with the use of his blue cards. Meanwhile, Soaz and Cyanide teaming up are going to start moving towards mid, or will they go into the enemy jungle? They're going to have a look at mid lane for now.
Oh, Froggen's playing it safe. While this is all happening, Niff has actually rotated, gone up towards the top. So he's joined Wicked just to hold this lane against them. And obviously, Tabs, he's getting free farm all down that bottom.
Yeah, and look how much farm Wicked is picking up now, because Niff is here to help him. Shook was running up as well in case someone from Fnatic was there to try and pressure Wicked and Niff. So Wicked can pick up all the farm here. He will share the experience, but it's better than the Maokai running around the jungle at the moment on 4 CS.
Oh, they're going to try and sneak around the backside. Tabs is completely unawares of this one. He's going to get slowed by the sapling, twisted in advance. Not going to be able to use. Cocoon will land, but Flash. Flash used by Tabs perfectly. Brilliant play.
Flash and heal, actually. So someone is completely used up there by Tabs, and that's a danger. A little bit far up in his lane. No ward to actually spot anyone coming in behind him, and that means now that Soaz, similar to what we see with Wicked in the top lane and the presence of Niff, will now have a bit more time to farm up a bit, and he's actually fallen a decent chunk of gold behind, to be honest, because of that in these early stages. And up at level 4. Of course, once he hits level 6, that's when he's going to be feeling a lot more confident. And actually goes in for the attack towards Rekkles. It was a simple headbutt and the old auto-attack trick as it goes through.
And it's a lane now with double heal against Zilean, who's great at poking if there's no sustain. But Yellowside are not really able to poke Wicked and Niff down because they can just heal each other, and they can sit in this lane, keep farming. They're going to need the help of Cyanide if they actually want to stop Wicked from farming in this lane.
Tabs tried to bait something out down the bottom, pretending to recall, but again, as he's mentioned, Wicked wiping out this wave, double heals, counteracting the bombs. Of course, they're only really probably level 1 bombs from Yellowstar, so not going to do a great deal of damage. He hasn't exactly got ability power stacked on him. Cyanide down in this bottom wave, trying to create a play maybe if Tabs steps a little too far forward, but with that flash and heal already down, he's going to play this one very safe.
And this is the risky thing about the tactic from Alliance with sending Niff in the top lane to lane with Wicked is that Tabs is all alone, and now there's two members from Fnatic down here potentially setting up for a kill. We actually do see Shook instantly reacting and saying, okay, I don't want to have a situation where my AD carry can't farm, so I'm instantly going to run to this bottom lane and make sure he can pick up the farm he needs.
And behind those minion line as well, not exactly in the most dangerous position as he just continues to farm it up, and Shook has been spotted. They should realize that as well with the fact that Fnatic just instantly backed away from things. Niff also did just recall and then come down this bottom side of the map, and it looks like Niff's going to spend a fair amount of time here moving around and trying to open up some opportunities elsewhere. Also worth mentioning now is that both mid laners have hit their level 6 mark and have the ultimates.
Yeah, we do also see Alliance place a ping ward around the dragon. They're trying to set up if they do see Rekkles return to this top lane after. That one missed, and that one missed. Last one hit. Shook, you get a point.
Sidestepped all of that one. You saw Chum the Waters go out. That's going to be on a cooldown. It's a fairly quick one for Froggen, but I think they wanted to make that play and force the dragon out. Instead, it's not going to happen. It will be a red buff return for Shook. Tabs in that bottom lane, back in there, going towards that Trinity Force, while Rekkles, now going back to the top lane, is going to go towards, of course, that Blade the Rune King.
Yeah, and now with Rekkles returning to this top lane, already wards placed by Alliance, they're pushing out the bottom lane into the tower. We can see them just go straight for Dragon. They do have to teleport on Wicked. He can join in, so it's going to be 5 versus 4 in favor of Alliance here. And you just see Tabs and Niff on this bottom lane, instant push it into the tower, so it opens up for the opportunity to go Dragon if they want to, and force Source to stay at least for a while on the tower to pick up the experience.
Good damage on that tower right now. Half the hit points gone. Ping ward was not spotted by Fnatic this time around. It is in the old standards position in the Deathbush. Shook's going to head back, so we're not going to see a dragon just yet. Deep ward placed by Yellowstar over on the blue buff, which is up right now. We'll see whether they make any use of that one. Tab's burning down the damage on this hit point tower, though.
Yeah, we actually saw that Fnatic realized that Alliance had got that ward in there. The same was done from both sides. So both teams do have vision around the dragon, or at least from Alliance's side, it's on the ramp. They see Niff actually moving in to get that ward down that was placed just a few moments ago. And that could open things up here. Shook has now started to move back out of the base after previously recalling. Froggen is going to start to move in here as well. Reckless, it's worth noting, along with Yellowstar, both on the top side of River. So Alliance should get this one down.
And Yellowstar was actually hiding in the top lane. He didn't show himself for at least half a minute, where Alliance were, okay, let's just recall. We don't have to take the dragon when there can potentially be four members from Fnatic. And then as soon as Yellowstar showed himself and Shook returned from base, instantly they just went in towards the dragon. They knew they could take it. It could only be three members from Fnatic to try and defend. Easy dragon. It is the trade you have to take. And so what's beautiful dodge around here. Oh, Shook is there.
Shook is there, kicks him back to the tower. They might have enough damage, and Tab gets himself first blood. Now the top lane. Wicked's had to back away from this one because Fnatic stole away the blue buff. Now pushing the tower. It's going to be one apiece.
And there was no ward. If you notice down here around the blue buff of Fnatic, there was no ward to spot Shook moving in behind Soas here. So he had no idea he was coming. And as soon as he appeared, easy kill for Alliance here. First blood, Dragon will have to get this top tower here, but the bottom lane tower is very low as well.
Reckless got a big wave in front of him there, was just trying to let the tower burn through as much as he could. Tabs will take the bottom as well, so we get an exchange on that. And in terms of gold, it leaves Alliance with a lead. Not a massive one, though, at this point. Around about 700 gold, but Fnatic, for now, not stopping. They're actually moving towards the inner turret, but both Alistar, who, by the way, has hit level 6 now, so has his damage reduction, plus Niff, who shouldn't be too far away yet. We can see his XP bar down in the bottom left. He will be hitting that within these next couple of minions.
He's also got that Sheen complete as well, so those headbutts are going to start beginning to do a lot of damage to the likes of Reckless and the other stuff. They stick around, which is why we're going to see them back away. Potentially, I wouldn't say go down bottom, but it seems they're heading for the mid lane turret.
Well, so there's, I mean, Froggen can only clear the wave if he can actually jump into the minions, which you can't do if a lot of members are pushing onto your tower here. But there's already Niff and Shook staying around in case there's going to be a push from Fnatic. The main wave there, however, is actually going to be Taps, which is not ideal. Unless, again, Froggen can jump into the minion. So not a lot of wave there from the combo.
Whoa!
That was beautiful.
Yellowstar, and he's in a lot of trouble. Trying to speed up, has to flash away. Tidal wave will come through. Yellowstar actually sidestepping that one. The fish is going to go on towards Soaz. Froggen still wants Yellowstar, who uses the exhaust. But Tabs coming in range as well. He will flash in, and Tabs gets another one. In the meantime, Nip falling low. Soaz needs to be careful. Bubble is going to land on him. And that is a freebie. Soaz going far too deep. Wicked and TP'd in as well. And just like that, Alliance are going to pick up kills left and right.
That was such a nice tidal wave by Niff here. He used it to block the entrance towards the blue buff here from Yellowstar. So he was forced to run down towards the bottom lane where both Tabs and Froggen couldn't chase him. Let's just see it again. Goes onto Yellowstar, kick flash him. And Yellowstar, at this point, he doesn't want to use the flash. He wants to save it for the tidal wave or for the bubble. Use it on the bubble, and then you see the tidal wave blocking the entrance here. Yellowstar forced to run down to this bottom lane. Tabs joins in. Froggen can chase him, kill him. And at the same time, Expecan pops his ulti here, wants to join in, but they're going for Niff and Soas over chasing, even though there's a teleport behind.
Teleport also came out of Wicked. He joined in towards the pit, but was not required, so that was going to be on a cooldown. So 3-0 early lead for Alliance. It's what they said in the opening feature, talking about how if Alliance do get ahead, they are very hard to stop their momentum as they push on through. Frankly, it's been Fnatic's misplays, I think you could say, more than Alliance's great players that's put them in this situation. It was more of a kill of opportunity they were going to go for, but instead, now they're going to try to move on towards Froggen. He's just going to sidestep everything.
And the thing is, if you look back to the semi-final, Alliance versus SK Gaming, sounds strange to say, but SK actually had early game leads against them in every single of those four matches that they ended up playing in the semi. So this is a completely different Alliance. We know them later on to be a team that is very, very good at closing out games, that generally don't make mistakes, and they will capitalize on their enemy's mistakes. So this is a real dangerous scenario for Fnatic to be in.
And it's simply also because Fnatic, whenever they do play Vayne, And there's so much time and so much effort into getting Red Sage. He's going for a Wicked here. Let's see if he can pick up a kill. Remember, he had tons of true damage.
Double ulti used. Wicked's ultimate is about to wear off, and Reckless may be able to get the chase on here. He's going to sidestep him round. He's in trouble. He will get the kill. And Reckless picks up the first for Fnatic.
And Reckless is actually maxing his W here also for the true damage against Wicked. So the Vayne pick was a response to the expected Alistar from Alliance. He didn't pick to stun it, even though it was open, making it a little bit risky for him in the late game. We're going to see how he can handle himself. Very important he gets a kill, because again, this lane swap was all about him getting the farm. Now onto the top lane.
Diving in towards Nip, he will throw down the tidal wave, but he's been separated from the rest of them. Shook and Tabs just trying to do damage to the side. Nip somehow still alive from this one. There is the shield, the kick from Shook as well, and they managed to save him.
Shook is such a good Lee Sin player. He's just everywhere at the right time. Nice save here. He was the guy who set up all the kills. He's been part of every single kill from Alliance. Reckless will be able to respond though and get this bottom lane tower and get some more gold for Fnatic.
Yeah, it's the second tower of the game. Fnatic now leading in that stage. Top and bottom taken down. Wicked returns. Look at this. Reckless cancels his recall. Ultimate not available
to the wall
for Wicked. Reckless ultimate not up either, but he didn't fancy it. Trinity Force has been completed by Wicked, but he's still sticking around. Not going to back away. Ultimate back off cooldown shortly. Wicked, yeah. He's like, nope, nope, not having any of this. Dragon's going to be coming up in a moment. They're going to move towards the mid lane.
Good little ward steal as well. And Reckless, we saw a ping coming down onto the tri-bush. They didn't have any vision then. They were worried, I think, that someone was about to come down there to support Wicked. And if Reckless had started things off, could have actually put himself in a bad scenario. Play it safe. Something that we're used to, you know, Reckless is definitely develop more confidence, I think, in taking some riskier plays, but something like that is kind of typical Reckless. I think 9 times out of 10 we'll see him back off rather than risk a 1v1 without any vision.
Yeah, it's just smart play. I mean, we do see some teams just go over aggressive even though they don't know about anyone.
Whoa.
Else. Like Expecta here.
Yeah, going straight in towards him. Has to pop the ghost. Chum the waters does not land, and Wicked should escape this one, but it may trigger the dragon. That's the mid laner without Destiny. It's going to be up in a couple of seconds, though. So he's going to head back to base and then come straight back. He's just going to shove that wave in. Instead, they're going for the tower. The mid tower's on next to no health, so they should just trade this one.
Okay, so again, Fnatic, they don't want to take any chance here. Both summoners used by Spec in the mid lane, give up the dragon, trade it for tower, and once again, your Vayne is just sitting in this bottom lane and keep farming, setting up here for a kill. No ulti on Froggen, remember. He's gonna knock him into the wall. Nope. Nice drag.
There's a rappel coming. It's all about the cocoon, which lands onto Froggen. Well, flash for the silver bolt. Final proc will work, and Reckless gets himself a second kill of the game. Always scary when these hyper carries that we've harped on about for both of these players get the kill, and funnily enough, his opposite number, Tabs, is also sat at 3-0-0. Yep. They're going to be just as important, if not more so, than we thought in this game.
And I really want to see how fast Reckless can actually kill Wicked in the late game, even though Wicked will pop his ulti because of the true damage from Reckless W. And just see if Wicked is actually able to stand in front of him by enough time for Tabs to do the same damage to Soas on the Maokai. Gonna be a big question in the late game here, but definitely great start for both AD carries. The best in their position in Europe.
Lichbane first item for Froggen. Ralanamakon was picked up by Peke. He wants to burn through that cow if he gets a chance. Also, with the blue buff being picked up by them, Fnatic, you've got to feel, are reacting very well to Alliance's early lead right now. Now the battle is all about vision, and it's Fnatic that have the most wards down. It's been Yellow Star predominantly that is led throughout in terms of ward placements. So you've got to feel Fnatic may well have the advantage here.
And just credit to Fnatic again for the fact they don't pick a stupid fight here in the mid game where they're just waiting for Reckless to scale up. They're waiting for Spectre to scale up as well. Like Twisted Fate needs to get items before he can really start doing damage in the late game. So they didn't take a risky dragon fight. Instead, traded for a tower. They take the safe option every single time and manage to pick up enough gold now. In this mid lane, Alliance pushing in. 4 members.
It's a big push as well. 4 of them there. We are going to see both Yellow Star and Cyanide start to come around, but I think it might be a little bit late. Tabs is going to just stick there. Auto attacks will be enough to take the tower. That was a nice, fast little push from Alliance.
That was just brute force, like moving in 4 members. Minions died. They stayed on the tower and killed it. And nobody from Fnatic could react in time. Was enough just with Expected to clear it. That's a bomb which doesn't do too much.
No, not a lot of damage. It's not really a scary bomb at the moment, but That's not what he's picked for. That ultimate is indeed a lifesaver. So top lane shoved off. Wicked done enough to keep that one steady. Alliance, well, they're thinking whether they're going to try and counteract here. Can they go towards that blue buff steel? May well be up shortly. Instead, they are all spotted out by that ward in the river. So Fnatic have full vision. Tried to be a scumbag there and stop the recall. Tabs, Froggen is indeed getting himself some free farm. These two teams, two mid laners, obviously both hold the records in farm, and they're keeping it going down that bottom lane. So everybody at the moment just trying to gauge themselves a bit of a position on the map.
And notice how Fnatic, they just keep sending Reckless to the lane where Wicked is, because he can kill him. He's going for him. He has red buff. There's no flash on Wicked.
Oh, this could be real bad news. That Blade of the Rune King gonna be used here once he does. In fact,
oh,
it
oh,
and Wicked being ripped to pieces. There is a TP coming in. Oh, it was
how
TP out. When you've got a condemn, your TP is just useless. Oh, Pekka, they'll be chased out by Shook. There's
the
King
from Yellow Star.
In and it's finished off.
Yellow Star will just trying to get in range for ulti, it didn't happen. So trade one for one, but once again, the kill goes over to Reckless here. He keeps looking for Wicked. Every time Wicked is sitting in the lane, he goes towards him.
Look at the mid lane. You can see Alliance trying to take advantage of this one, shoving in. Froggen playing simple defender in the river, keeping two of them busy while the rest of the team try to shove up and create something. But Soaz is there, the defender of the tower. Oh, Chum the Waters thrown towards Yellowstar. Froggen going for this one. Lichbane proc goes out. He's going to have to use that ultimate on himself, but how's he going to get out of this one? In comes the rest of the team. There's no escape. Surely Flash is available. Caught with the Acro Prison. Froggen gets the kill.
Nice little setup here. So baiting or forcing Fnatic to move through the river if they want to try and do stop the push. Let's just see the kill once again from
this
Reckless.
This is brilliant.
Just wait for the Flash. Wicked goes in. He knows I can't really run from him. Instant Flash. The Q in. Avoids the knock up, saves the condemn as well. Before the teleport actually came in. And
oh,
actually, this top lane.
Oh, Reckless though, he chases a lot of people coming around, but the rest of Fnatic now joining in. Ignite is on Reckless. He tries to get away, but that's not enough. They trade one for one in the end though, and it will be Pekka managing to take out Shook. The remaining three of Fnatic there will simply back away. Alliance, I don't think, have enough to chase here with that ultimate from Froggen still down.
Keep trading one for one. They trade towers, they trade objectives. Yeah, these two teams are so even at the moment. And it's all about getting kills on the AD carries. I mean, look at Tabs. Four kills picked up for him. Three kills for Reckless. Looking good for both of them. But both mid laners, they want to join in. They want to be part of the kills, but only being able to pick up one.
Yeah, it's the meta that's not helping them right now. They want to be involved in everything, but good counterplay from both teams so far. Dragon up in 37 seconds. Yellow Star once again doing his job, coming in, clearing out the pink wards, getting themselves some vision in and around it. Bottom lane is shoving in the favor of Fnatic. That will help out. Tabs is going to have to pick up this red buff and quickly go down, sweep out that wave that is pushing. That's going to give him a big chunk of farm. He's actually ahead at the moment on Reckless in terms of gold and farm. You can see just 1,200 gold ahead. That's a big, big difference moving in towards this dragon fight.
Look at the items here from XPEC. He's going early magic resist. Wants to make sure Froggen can just one-shot him. But there's still the physical damage coming from the auto attack from Tabs. Will of course be some of the magic damage as well, but still, XPEC is playing very defensive with Phil.
It looks like this dragon is just going to be given away to Alliance. Fnatic not really getting involved. They're going to push that top lane. Question is, can they actually finish this tower off? Or how much damage will they really do before Alistair gets in? He needs to send a second person up there though, because of Yellow Star having his ultimate on cooldown. Reckless could dive him under the tower, and we've already seen what happens when they get involved. Cyanide is there, the Pulverize comes down, but Wicked honestly can't do all that much. They're trying to actually kill off Soaz here inside of the river. Shook and Froggen gonna dive onto him. Ultimate running here, the fish will come out. Pekka is gonna join him from the side. He gets hit by the tidal wave. Oh, he has to flash from the bubble as well. Destiny is gonna be popped. He's surely gonna escape with that one. We also saw Yellow Star go down after Tabs came into hell.
Didn't even pop his ult here. Actually just ended up dying. Two members from Alliance. Again, three members from Fnatic managed to pick up a kill while the rest of Alliance is chasing Source. Second time already, he's been caught out of position and ended up dying. Let's see it again. Wicked is trying to do his best to keep Reckless and Yellowstar off the tower here. Then Tab joins in. Sana is there as well. They go for Yellowstar. He has ulti. And decides not to use it.
Use it. Fair enough.
Maybe even, I'm not sure if he spent the last of his mana actually on trying to speed himself and then he couldn't afford to pop the ulti and therefore end up dying. But that was definitely the wrong decision, especially because Sana was joining in to turn it around.
Well, it's a five kill Cogmore for Tabs nonetheless, and that's given the Blade of the Rune King completion. And look at that, the goal difference. It's been close. This is between the two AD carries, but it is Tabs that is once again stretched in the lead. This is the big fight between these two. Mid laners really haven't got going, and nor have the top laners. They've been simple bystanders throughout this match so far. It's an 8-4 lead for Alliance in terms of kills. Well, of course, equates to close to 4,000 gold. Still yet to get this turret in the top lane, but Cyanide's getting chased here. That's Chum the Waters lands perfectly. Fine. Blind Chum the Waters. Cyanide goes down. It's Froggen that takes it.
Froggen. That was such a nice setup here. Didn't have any ward in the bush and still managed to hit it onto Cyanide here. Now Alliance pushing up four members in the mid lane. Wicked is pushing here. Source will be able to get the tower in the top lane because he's still fairly low. And Reckless once again wants a piece of the cow.
Play the Rune King actually used Tumble. We'll bring him in closer, but actually backed away. And funnily enough, there's no one there to help him. He could have chased that one down. Alliance moving on towards that turret. Soaz is also doing the damage to that top inner turret. So it's going to be inner turrets traded here between the two teams. Obviously, Cyanide as a man going down in that last fight before it actually happened. And now it looks like target's Reckless.
Well, Froggen's gonna come across. I think he, yeah, tumbles away. Should be safe. He's got the support of Yellow Star just around the side. So Alliance trying to close the net. Didn't want to go too deep on it though. So very, very close this game still. Despite the 4,000 gold advantage, we have yet to see a big full-on brawl, a big brawling team fight. The AD carries yet to actually clash either.
Yeah.
They've pretty much stayed the distance from one another.
But they don't really have to group up because, again, Fnatic, they know they're a bit weaker here in the early to mid games, so don't want to take any risky fights. They give the dragons to Alliance, trade it for towers, and then AD carries has basically just been looking for the enemy top laner and just keep going towards them and try and kill them. It's paid off because, again, look at the kills. Two deaths for Wicked, died to Wicked twice. We had 3 deaths for Source. You got ganked the first time, then you got caught out of position twice, end up dying. And Froggen as well, been picking up some kills lately, so looking very good for him on Fizz and take notes overpower. Our last second item here, so Alliance can look to teamfight. We can see Froggen dive in towards the backline of Fnatic, pop the Hourglass, wait for his E to be ready, and then jump out again.
Interested to see how that all works out for him going forward. Reckless once again has been sent up to this top lane to farm and push that one down. He needs to be really careful. We see Alliance now moving in towards the enemy jungle, and this is where those wards become all the more important the further that we go on. When, to be honest, both teams have great pick potential that you're gonna fall foul to if you don't have vision.
Especially also, the weird thing actually is, Fnatic has the resilient, but we haven't seen Yellowstar use a single ult yet. Even though there's been all these like single target picks where he's been able, or he's actually been around for most of them, but he was just never in a position to either get the ulti off, or he was out of mana, or just didn't time it correctly. So the Zillion pick so far hasn't really paid off for Fnatic.
Peke yet to get his split push on because he cannot compete with Froggen. If he was to face him, he would get taken down. See Froggen going back down towards that bottom wave, gonna keep it pushing in their favor. Reckless sneaking across the side. This time around though, there is two members of Alliance there. Are they gonna try to go for this one? There's wards from Alliance. They will spot them. Cyanide will get spotted coming around the side. Destiny popped. Where's he going? Mid lane wants the lock on towards Nif, but a great Aqua Prism. Deep, deep dive coming out of Fnatic here. The wave from Nif. Is it enough to get him away? Yes, it is. And the rest of Alliance are gonna close the net on towards them. Chum the Waters fired out. Not quite in range. Off the side, we're gonna see the battle of the AD carries. Tabs is coming round the side. Wicked missed the ball race. Then he gets it with the headbutt. Peke now focused out there. The ultimate running from Wicked is gonna be enough to prevent all the damage. Zonya's Outglass is gonna do nothing. The Zillion ultimate will protect him briefly. He's got flash up in a second. Not gonna be enough. Tabs gets the kill.
This could be Baron here. I mean, Fnatic or Alliance instant moving towards the Baron. Two members dead. Source is alive with full HP and Reckless and Yellowstone in this mid lane here. Will they actually go in and try and stop it? Froggen is recalling. There's only four members from Alliance here.
Makes it very dangerous. Nif is still low. It's got to be Reckless, surely, to be the hero in this scenario. There is a ward coming over the top, so Fnatic know for sure that that Baron has been started. They turn around, going to go towards Yellowstar. He will flash straight up. Tab's not got much mana here. That could actually really affect what he can do damage-wise, but the Baron is still being done. Alliance really holding on to that one. Cyanide is coming back into it. I think the Baron, though, is going to go down here, and he does go to Alliance.
And this was Fnatic trying to set up a play here. They want to kill Nif in the mid lane. He survived, just rolled again. Yeah, so Teleport coming in from Xpeke. and Swords is in the mid lane as well. Meanwhile, they're fighting here. Sanath drops fairly low. He's going to be the first target Alliance actually wants to kill here. Reckless managed to escape, but his ulti is gone here. In this mid lane, three members from Fnatic now running, or four members, sorry. Sanath is solo. Wicked goes in, misses the Q, but he will get it with the headbutt and the auto attack in the air. Kills him. No ulti used by Yellowstar, by the way. He saves it. Pumps it on his Pekka when it's way too late anyway. He's going to die. Hoping maybe at flashing time, but it would have been easy for Alliance to follow him and kill him.
Wicked didn't miss the pulverize at the end there, though, so just point that one out. They were equally as easy, in my opinion. He was right at the front of him, but
he got the headbutt anyway. He got the kill.
Yeah, he got the important one.
Ooh, and this is risky.
His first kill as well. Reckless down on this bottom side.
They were trying to set a trap down the bottom there, and Alliance might be able to just shove straight at the mid lane here. Tabs is actually getting red buff, though, so it's going to delay them for now, but Reckless is sticking around. I think he wants to try and rush down towards that inner turret while the rest of Alliance are up in the top half of the map.
Fnatic is in a situation where they need to try something desperate. Even though there's Baron on the side of
Alliance, pushing.
They have to do something here. They're going for this tower. Want to force Alliance to recall, but they're just going to trade for top tower.
Oh, this could
be dangerous. Going down to defend it.
Yeah, there's recalls coming in as well on the top side of the map. So Fnatic going to get this inner turret. Tab's already there. Nip and walk down. So they trade one for one, although it's outer for inner. If you really want to look at the semantics there, Wicked, though, is going to have some free time and a big, big wave with him as well, which he can obviously keep healing up. Stop a couple more turret hits actually getting kills onto those minions, and I think there's enough of them there to just finish off this tower. Nice little push at the end from Alliance.
So Fnatic have given up so much gold to Alliance through the dragons. They're constantly giving up kills as well. I mean, we see Tabs, you had 5 kills very early on in the game. Froggen started running around, getting all the kills. So both teams with their pick comp style here has gone in favor of Alliance. And then we also, like, if you look at the items for Fnatic, the fact that Xpeki felt like he was forced to go early magic resist means he doesn't have a lot of damage just yet. It also means if we do get the 5v5, it's all about Reckless doing the damage, which is not going to be enough. And if you do look at the late game scaling, well, Alliance, you have Fizz and Tap as well going to scale great into late game. The only difference is they don't have a Maokai, but they have the 70% damage reduction Alistar instead. So it's not like it's not even like Alliance is in a worse position going into the late game. And they are so far ahead now. Look at the siege up on this tower.
Well, with the range of Kog'Maw, it may well be able to get that poke damage on towards him. And Wicked, though, could he get jeweled off at the side here? Nope, Froggen's going to join him. The rest of Alliance rotate around, and that's another inner turret being picked up for Alliance. That will be their 6th of the game, and now it's just the base that they are staring at. Can they unlock the shell that Fnatic have? Can they start knocking on the door? We're only 31 minutes in. It's a pretty fast game, in all honesty, and this is a pretty much the best of 5 series beginning that we really wanted to see. Both these teams really are looking tight.
A lot of action, a lot of focus on AD carries, getting the kills, doing well. And we haven't actually seen a straight up 5v5. It's just been picks and small fights everywhere on the map. And then Alliance, of course, pick up the Baron in the end where Fnatic went too over aggressive. They wanted to kill Nif in the mid lane, completely backfired. Alliance going towards the bot lane now.
Yep, just going to swing straight around, do some damage to this one. The middle turret already down to half. There's the bubble on towards 99. They're going to follow through. The ultimate from Zillion was used, so that's not going to be there for these next few moments. Froggen actually going pretty deep, but the tower nonetheless will fall down. So first inhibitor now going in the favor of Alliance. They should be able to just go straight to the mid lane and finish off the tower there.
Amazing stuff, honestly. Alliance, dominant control. All they needed to do was pick off that one target. Look at Tabs, not messing around, using that range of Kog'Maw, and he is just burning down the towers and sidesteps the cocoon, and that was enough. That was all they needed to do. Quick Aqua Prison comes out from Nif and just forces Alliance to go forward. And Fnatic now, they're going to have to deal with this. All Alliance need to do, just delay. They've got the double heal. They can sustain through a lot of this damage. And now you can see super minions coming in. The wave comes through.
Final wave with the fish. Wicked pops his ulti. Soas dives into the middle of them. He's going to go down. The rest of the team don't really follow up. Shook on a bit too deep though. Gets condemned against the wall. Managed to get away though. The shield comes in.
Now
Peke being ripped to pieces by Tab. He will get away and be able to heal. But they're surely going to lose the inhib turret. Will the inhibitor fall as well? I think our lines are done for this push.
And Tab was just completely untouched in this fight here. He even went for early banshees because, well, who's going to dive towards him? It's going to be Source, it's going to be Xpeka, and that's magic damage. So early magic resist here, they won't be able to kill him. They're going to need Reckless to be there, but he can't do it. There's going to be a cow in his face, there's going to be Lee Sin in his face, and Froggen is just looking to try and kill him every single team fight. So Fnatic don't have anyone who can dive in, kill taps, they can place a bomb and stop the recoil just to be annoying though.
Yeah, just annoying. It means Fnatic can move in and clear out the walls. But look at this, the play from Shook.
So Alliance here, looking for the dive because there's no ulti for Yellowstar just yet. They go into Cyanide, he managed to stay alive. And Source actually goes into the back line here, goes for Nif. He stays alive as well, like nobody's going down. And then Shook in the very end, flash over, uses the safeguard just to survive in the very end. And everyone stays alive.
So, so close, and taps from behind the wall, almost picking himself up another couple of kills right after that. We've actually got Dragon in less than half a minute's time. It looks like Alliance want that last bit of cash injection before they end up going towards what could be a final push. There is Blue Buff started. Shook comes in and says, hang on a minute, don't think you're getting that. That's going over to Froggen. Get back in your base and defend.
Slide through with the Urgent Strike. Dragon is up in 2 seconds, but they don't care about that. I think Baron may well be the next focus. Red Buff looks like it's up. Tams wants that. We'll help him out. There's the Dragon. They're going over to take that one. And Fnatic, simply on defensive duties, they need to prevent those super minions on the side, because if they're allowed to shove up, that would buy free time for Alliance to just go straight up to Baron while the super minions beat on the Nexus turret. So Soaz clearing those out, Wreckers are going to help them, and then they just need to make fast tracks to Baron, it seems, because Alliance, they're going to shove this wave and move straight for it.
And there's some good defensive wards by Fnatic. They bought the time while Alliance were doing Dragon to just place a few wards here. But it's not enough. They don't really have the option to place enough, because Alliance will instantly go into the Baron pit here, take full control of it, force Fnatic away, and then they can start clearing the wards anyway. Yellowstar trying to do what he can to get a few wards just around, trying to dodge around the pink wards, see if he can keep it at least to spot if Alliance does start the Baron. Sanad is great at smiting. He does a flash, he does a smite at this point, so he could potentially go for a steal. But there, seems like Fnatic want to try and force Alliance away from this Baron pit and make them run to the mid lane.
Yeah, by doing that middle inner turret, which they do manage to get down. However, they need to be careful, because the furthest lane away from the Baron itself is pushing through with super minions. So they've got to make a decision here very shortly. Do they send Soaz back, who does have teleport, to defend this base? Alliance can just push middle. Fnatic are out of position. You can see all of them going to recall. It might be too late, at least to save this inhib. In the bottom left, you can see that the super minions did get through. Already taken one Nexus, turn it down to half.
They're going straight through. Inhibitor will go down. Super minions working their way through. Alliance rotate, ready and waiting for that respawn. They're going to get the second inhibitor down. Cyanide caught out. They're going to go aggressive. Fnatic trying to catch on towards it. Reckless pops the ultimate. He's looking for Wicked, but Wicked just going to hit, shrug them off. There's the wave. Shoots them apart. Soaz separated from his team. Has not got the hit points. Will get the regen. Yellowstar gets the revive on towards him. Cyanide leaps away. Soaz goes back in again, but it's just not enough for him. Sonic waves on Peke. Now Yellowstar, he's focused out. Reckless comes back in. Has he got the damage? No! Inhibitor goes down and they're all forced back to the Fountain. Alliance, they're going to retreat. The Baron is still up, remember. They could just choose that as a target and push on whack.
And again, Taps is completely untouched in these fights here. Nobody can get to him. It doesn't even matter you get Wicked low, it doesn't matter you get Shook low. Taps is just sitting in the back line, destroying you, together with Froggen, who's dancing around. He has the Hourglass as well. Didn't even have to use it in the last fight. And this was, again, Fnatic, they knew they had to just try and engage. I mean, you can't let both your inhibitors die. Watch the enemy team take Baron as well. You might as well try one last fight here. It didn't pay off for them. Now they have to try and challenge the Baron.
Well, there is the Destiny used to get vision of Alliance. He sees them having the Baron already down to less than half. Cyanide on the outside is going to try and be a hero here for Fnatic, but he's already taken super low. There is Shook going over, kicks him away. Taps will finish off the kill, and now Wicked diving in. He will actually be killed off. Froggen forced to use his Zhonya's as well. Yellowstar getting knocked down, but he's used his ultimate on himself. Reckless has got to go big here, looking around to see which target he can go for next. Alliance are all pretty low without Tab Fink factored into that one. He will actually turn around. They go back in on towards Peke. Shook be baited. He safeguards off of the side. And now Soaz going to be pushed down. Oh my god, he survived it somehow. Shook does come through and they finally kill him off. That's a 3-for-2 up until now. Baron, of course, went to Alliance. Fnatic have to retreat with just Reckless and Yellowstar alive.
We'll be able to come back and defend for a minute here, but look at Alliance. They're not done yet. They want to chase him into the base, see if they can actually kill a Nexus turret.
Super minion still in there. Cyanide back up in 5 seconds. This is risky from Alliance, honestly. They do have that Baron buff on. They want to try and pressure out Reckless. Oh, look at that. Yellowstar just gets shredded by Tabs there. They take down one. Nexus doing the Aqua Prison catches. Cyanide's in trouble. He gets caught out. Teleport comes in. Wicked's going to join the party. The second Nexus through will fall. And it's going to be Alliance. Can they get down the Nexus? Reckless sticking around the Fancy, trying to keep them away. But Tabs is free hitting off the side. He fancies a kill. Hit the goddamn Nexus. Ignore the AD carry. Where are you going, man?
He wants
get
MVP on the Nexus.
Alliance take game one. Wow, this best of five. This is going to be incredible. But it's Alliance that strike first against the reigning champions in the Aura of Fnatic.
And looking at the picks here, Fnatic's comp was so risky. Both Xpecta and Reckless just had to snowball early mid-game. Otherwise, they wouldn't be able to teamfight Alliance like we just saw here. They fell behind. They traded kills to the start. Then Fnatic realized we cannot fight for Dragon. We have to give every single Dragon to Alliance to try and take towers instead and hope Reckless can keep getting kills. As soon as Wicked stopped dying to Reckless in these one-on-ones, he couldn't find any more kills. Everyone else from Alliance joined in, and they were just stronger from the start. I mean, Froggen on Fizz as well looked so good in this game. Slow start, but as soon as he had the chance to get some kills, he got five in a row.
And Tabs, again, you said it before that although Reckless is MVP, Tabs is going to want to almost steal that back from him somehow. And you saw it at the end. You were saying, hit the damn Nexus, man, where you going? That's where he was going. He was chasing the MVP down the lane to get a bit of a bonus kill at the end.
Yeah, MVP my ass is what he was thinking. 8-0-7 for Tabs. That's impressive play. 4-1-2 for Reckless. They didn't really come against each other too often. They pretty much avoided each other. It's like you said, they wanted to switch away from it. We should also maybe look towards the mid lane because that's an important one. Peke, only 2-3-1.
Yeah.
While, of course, Froggen, 5-2-4, managed to find out the split push, managed to get his groove, whereas Peke seemed to be having to react every single time. He wasn't really the one making the plays.
We saw one aggressive tier of ulti. It was used on Niff in the mid lane, which actually ended up backfiring with two members of Fnatic die, and they gave up the first Baron to Alliance. Yeah, that was the only aggressive Twisted Fate ult we saw. They weren't able to set it up because Alliance was constantly finding Fnatic out of position. They were constantly getting the picks here. So instead of Reckless standing in the lane, getting a one-on-one, and then Xpecta joining in to make a 2v1, get the kill, push a tower, it was just every single time Alliance being aggressive, finding the right picks, and then Xpecta could never use his ulti like he wanted to. The only time he did, backfired, and they were just too far behind at that point. So insanely risky comp they're playing here. And Source on this Maokai is not really the champion. It was just, he was caught out of position so many times in the early game. That was one of the reasons we had all the kills on Tapped in the early game as well.
That was actually my next point that I was going to make, that Fnatic banned Maokai in the semifinals. They said, we don't want to deal with it. Told me that they didn't want to really fight for it as a first pick either. They picked it quite late on in this composition, so as it 1-6, I think it was, just looked to fall off in the game to almost, you know, it died a couple of times getting caught out. Typical SOAS reaction if you were looking at the player cameras, facepalm moment, and he's not a player that typically loses 1, 2, 3 kills in the early game and then comes back really strong. He is a very tilty player, as we like to say, and that could be a problem for them going forward. They need to kind of build SOAS's spirits back up. May start with not picking Maokai next time if he's not really feeling it.
Yeah, blue start for Fnatic, of course. First pick was a Kog'Maw. Worked very well. 8-0-7. Let's go over to Shox and Company to break down that first match.
Thank you very much, D-Man. Indeed, a very nice performance there from Alliance. D-Man touching it, the Kog'Maw. Fnatic having that Twitch as a last ban, which kind of forced out the AD carry picks and just the bottom lane pick. You're very impressed by that one.
Yeah, I'm very surprised Alliance got their hands on both Kog'Maw and Nami in the same game. When picks and bans rolled out, especially in Europe, they are the most contested AD carry and support picks. In the 16 games in Gamescom, there's been 7 Kog'Maw bans, there's been 6 Nami bans. After Kog was locked in, Krippo looked at me and said, Fnatic have to consider Nami. They did not. They didn't lock it in the first rotation. And both of those champions went massive for Alliance. Niff in particular, his bubbles were fantastic. His tidal waves were fantastic. And it was very well played. Fnatic, they played a bit recklessly with the Vayne, and they were risking it. It was either going to win them the game or was going to lose them the game. And this time around, it didn't work out.
Yeah, I do agree with what you're saying there. I think there is one counter to Nami Kog, and I think a well-played Braum Tristana can beat it, but it requires outplay on the opposing side, while Nami Kog is just really solid as a lane. However, I think the difference wasn't made in the champion, but more in the playstyle. I think Niff played really well. A lot of things he did went unnoticed, but his positional play around the map was really good. He was in the right spot at the right time, and it's really hard to do that as a support because, okay, the top lane's pushing in, you need to help your top laner defend that. Suddenly, you need to go bottom. River was warded, this gave Alliance Dragons. If you compare that to Yellowstar, yeah, he was trying to deal with Wicked in the top lane to keep him zoned, but they lost complete vision control over the bottom side of the map, and that gave Alliance a dragon and even more picks later on. And I'm just really impressed with the way Niff played, and a little disappointed in Yellowstar. I think he was drawn too far to the top lane, and he should just look at this game and say, maybe I could have been around the map a little more and just help my team a little more.
Yeah, the Zilean pick really didn't, it didn't really seem to work in any of the situations he was caught out in.
Yeah, just to cut in again, the Zilean pick has a little bit of potential though with the speed up, but if you go around the map and you're not in your lane, you can run down mid lane, speed up TF, he will be able to get into gold card range, or you go down bottom, you stealth gank, and you speed up Maokai, suddenly he's in range to catch somebody, combine that with Elise coming in. There is so much potential for Zilean, I just think it wasn't used.
Yeah, you mentioned it as well, if you're in that top lane and harassing a Kaute is just going to heal up while the Nami is roaming, that's not a very good thing to do. And you were mentioning as well in the early game, both teams were starting off pretty well, and then the flash was forced out of Kog'Maw in the bottom lane. They could have followed up Fnatic, but that's when they started making mistakes.
Yeah, I feel if you burn a Kog'Maw's flash and you have a Twisted Fate and a support that can potentially roam around the map, speed up a Maokai with Twisted Advance, there has to something has to happen there. Like that's a signal. You get his flash, he has to die, or that the just ganking it was wasted.
Yeah, despite the fact that Fnatic were making mistakes, and I think they were making executional mistakes and misplays in situations. They did have a few moments that were good, but just compositionally, the mistakes cost them so much so early on.
And you mentioned some things that were good. One of those things was a Reckless on the Vayne. He just one-on-one Wicked. Sometimes you see that he has gained that confidence to go up against them.
Yeah, he really, really did. You know, I actually think we got one of those LCS big plays, something I love to talk about. So I'm just going to cue this one right now. Comes from @lolunexpected. Reckless, outplaying Wicked, so sick. Flashing the Pulverize and stopping the TP with Condemn into the wall. It was fantastic. I jumped up. Let's roll that clip right now on your screen, because it was just great. And, initiates, I feel a bit bad for Wicked, because yes, he missed a couple of Pulverizes later in the game, but he was really picked on by Reckless's Vayne.
Yeah, he dodged, Reckless dodged one knock back and one knock up with a single flash. He literally went through Wicked, and then he just a straight up outplay. However, you see Wicked adapt later in the game. It's in the small things, but the next time they went up against each other, Wicked would use his W, see if Reckless would flash or not, and then hold his Q afterwards and not chain them together. And in the worst case, he would just knock Reckless back. So Wicked did adapt there, and I think next game, he'll know Reckless has this up his sleeve.
And maybe Reckless will adapt as well. It's something we saw in the first game, in the fourth game versus Rocket coming out of Fnatic, picking that Vayne, and it gets fed. And you even have a Zilean, yet there's not a lot you can do when you're making those communication mistakes all over the map as well. Let's actually take a look at a replay from a little later in the game, where, once again, they want to go all in on a Nami, but that doesn't pay off.
No, it really doesn't. And just to set this up very briefly, if you look at the minimap, Reckless is looking to find a kill onto Tabs near the top half of the map. And it feels like Peke, he popped his Destiny and may have had Soaz and Reckless maybe yelling in his ears, because he opted to go middle, opted to go for the support under the tower dive. Roll the clip out, and you'll notice that as Soaz and Peke are diving, trying to, you know, find a kill onto Nami, the rest of Alliance start grouping up and they start coming to re-engage and to punish. And this just summarizes the vast majority of the game. Fnatic making plays, not really being on the same page, and Alliance punishing.
See, and Wicked and Tabs coming in there and being able to clean up the fight was because of that miscommunication, because they took a fight that they knew they would win 2-3, but they would lose 2-2, and it ended up being 2-2, so they lost it. And then that swung the momentum in Alliance's favor, and they just circled around. Even though Wicked missed that Pulverize, so be it, he still got that kill.
Yeah.
And
still left Baron.
I think Alliance played really clean this game. They're positioning their players on different parts of the map was good. Reacting to situations was good. Like, everything that Fnatic threw at them, Alliance had an answer. And I'm just interested to see how this will play out in the next few games.
Well, if we think back of Fnatic lost the first game versus Rocket, but I feel like it's a different kind of loss here. When they had their losing streak, we saw them making one or two mistakes in the late game, and that would seal the deal. But here, it seems like it is more of a pressure thing. They are really struggling.
I actually agree with that. I feel like the mistakes that Fnatic made in this game are a tad uncharacteristic if you look at some of their other performances. And they are very, very marginal mistakes. You know, it's just very early on we've seen Pekka going top lane. to try go for a TP gank. And instead of trying to just focus Niff and kill him, the team sort of splits and they try to get two kills instead of one, get greedy. Shook is in the right place at the right time. He responds, kicks away the threat, and Niff gets out with his life. And that happened over and over again. Just that small little, oh, we can get two. No, you can't. Oh, we can get the gold card. No, you can't. And Alliance just punished.
Yeah, Alliance just really reacting very well. Also, a few minor slip-ups here and there, so the pressure is on for both of these teams. Remember Froggen dying on bottom, he could have technically flashed that cocoon, but I mean, let's not harp on these players. They made some sick moves as well. I believe Pekka sidestepped the fish like twice as well, so it's getting a pretty high level of League of Legends here, and I'm just like, I'm enjoying these matches. It's fun.
Yeah, that's the impression I got as well from watching, is that we're watching something a little bit higher than we've seen in the season so far, Quickshot.
Yeah, I agree, and I think one of the most interesting things is a lot of the other series that we've been watching, there's been a fairly heavy focus on like those top lane bans or the AD carry on the supports. Like I mentioned, you know, Kog and Nami have been banned out so many times this weekend. But this time, it is Pekka, it is Froggen that are being forced onto the non-traditional picks, while the so-called OP AD carries, the OP supports, Braum was up, Tristana was up, Maokai's up, Alistar's up. And it's going to be who can make use of the most powerful champions more effectively. And in this game, it wasn't necessarily the picks that decided it, but the decision-making with those picks. And I want to see if the trend continues, because these guys are going to adapt and change a whole lot this series.
Yeah, absolutely. So predictions for the next game, guys, or the series, if you feel risky.
I hope, actually, Fnatic goes for a 2v2, because I feel they got out-rotated by Alliance, or just out-positioned by Alliance, or if they just learn from this game and know that they have to spread their players more around the map, because that dragged Maokai down as well. They were harping on the Maokai pick a little bit, but he only went 0-3 because he had nobody near him in this side of the map, and Maokai's a CC champion. You need that follow-up. So Fnatic can win the next game if they play the way they did and just go for the laning phase.
Yeah, I was just going to say, I'd like to see stronger laning champions. I feel like the lanes, mid and duo for Fnatic in this game, forced them into some lane shenanigans, which they fell behind in. I think Alliance did the lane swap well. They got the first dragons. Laning champions, and then look to a stronger mid game.
All right, but we will see. We have to take a short break, but when we come back, it is game two, where Fnatic will look to even up the series 1-1. Don't touch your browser.
In the meantime, Nip falling low. So as Nip, be careful. Bubble is going to land on him.
Cyanide's getting chased here. That Chomp the Waters lands perfectly. Blind Chomp the Waters. Cyanide goes down.
And now Soas going to be pushed down. Oh my god, he survived it somehow. Shock does come through and they finally kill him off.